So this video is going to be about the recent downturn in the market. We're going to talk about the one family hedge fund blowing up a handful of stocks, and while this administration pushing on with delisting some of these Chinese companies that have no business being listed. So let's start there and then we'll work backwards. But before I start, I just want to say screw IG, bro. They blocked me from going live because last week when I posted about the Weimar Republic hyperinflation, how that led to Germany, and how the China virus is going to lead China to take over in a German-like, Hitler-like fashion. They said it was harmful and all this BS, and it blocked me. So that's the risk I take of, you know, putting this time, energy, and effort into making this page. And just like that, they have the power to take away everything. So I don't know. We'll see what happens from there. But anyways, back to what we're talking about. Hopefully they give me my rights back to go live. I'd rather do this live than make these videos now because it's better interaction with you guys. So right now we block these Chinese companies that are bad actors, and it's very, very important, right? Because forget about everybody else. Let's think about America first in this sense. Like, we need to protect our financial institutions, right? Like, we have to have credibility when we invest and we bring something to the public markets. So then our citizens, people like me and you, can go out and we know that we can make an educated investment decision because we trust what's in front of us, right? It's really that simple, right? Like, if you know, company XYZ got listed and they said, oh yeah, well, you know, we're doing $1 million, you know, dollars in sales and stuff like that. And, you know, me and you decided to invest in it because we're like, oh, they must be legit because they're doing $1 million in sales. This looks like a really good stock for us to buy. And it comes to turn out they're doing like $0 in sales. Then, you know, me and you probably aren't going to have faith in the system that's allowing us to purchase these securities, right? Because it's one thing if you make a bad decision on your own and you made the bad decision based on the numbers. It's another thing to be, you know, just taken advantage of like that, you know? And that's why we have the SEC for whatever they're worth. That's why we have these, you know, certain formations, why we do IPOs a certain way, why we have these regulations in place, why we have, you know, acts like Sarbanes-Oxley that require companies to report every 3 months and required to have, be independently audited, right? So you saw a lot of the Chinese companies get hit hard that probably shouldn't be listed at all. And the Bidu and the Tencent kind of fell into the hedge fund manager as well, because he was leveraging that up too. So first and foremost, you know, that thing's out of the way. Is it's not just Chinese companies, right? It's also American companies. It's any company that is not following these rules set up to protect the public should not be allowed to be traded. And it should not be as easy and as quick to list. It should be not a difficult process, but we definitely need to make sure that when we let a company trade public, even in over-the-counter markets, not just the big exchanges like the NASDAQ and stuff, we need to make sure that what they're saying is correct, because it's America's integrity, you know, on the line, right? It's our institution's integrity on the line. We want to be known as the country as in, no, wow, if you get listed on an American stock exchange, you could bet your bottom dollar that it's legit. And that you can invest in confidence, because that's how we're going to get other people to bring money in to invest in companies, you know, here. And so that's very important. So that's one of the things that caused a little bit of a hiccup last week. And then, of course, you got this, what's going on now, guys. So, you know, people like me and you are probably just retail investors, and we aren't, you know, privy to a bunch of these other, you know, like swaps, for example. Like, that's a pretty big thing. And I know a couple of guys that follow me are like really into the game, and they know exactly what it is. But, you know, I'm having to learn just like everybody else. Now, we know what credit default swaps are, you know, through the 2008, you know, housing crisis and stuff. So essentially just other types of swaps is just another derivative. Like, a stock option is a derivative, right? It's a bet on a bet. So you could bet on something to go up, or you could bet on something to go down, and you could leverage up 100-to-1 in one way, right? So the way swaps work, it's the same thing, but it's a way for bigger guys to make these bets. And you know, they're supposed to be more sophisticated investors. They're clearly, as you can see, they're not. They're just degenerates like everybody else, you know, trying to make a quick buck in a sense, right? So you know, this guy was leveraged up 5 times. So, you know, he, let's put it this way. The GameStop fiasco was $6 billion, and that caused a splash in the market. This family hedge fund was 20-something billion dollars. And no one's really saying anything about it because everyone's like, oh, shit, hush, hush, you know. But it's crazy because he got he was able to leverage, you know, 5 times up. And his positions were really concentrated. So, and plus, he was a family hedge fund. So from my understanding, when you have like a family hedge fund, you're usually just investing mostly with your own money and stuff, right? It's not like a regular hedge fund where you're gathering a large group of people's, you know, money. But, you know, he was able to use these swaps. And because there's not that much regulation with these swaps, it was like you saw the names, right? You saw like Goldman and Morgan and Stanley and all these other bigger banks that extended him credit to go ahead and make bets that he probably couldn't afford, because the average person is like, you know, you have like 1x, you know, leverage. And sometimes if you have a pretty big account, maybe you have 2x leverage depending on your relationship with your broker. But this guy was able to leverage 5 times the amount of money that he had, and he just did high concentration and made bets, you know, on these individual stocks. And, you know, when things started to go south, I guess you could call it like the unwinding was a combination of us continuing to delist these Chinese companies. So he had exposure to Chinese companies, and also just so happened that Viacom at the time, I should have sold off at 90, because you guys know me, I've always said this, the second a company issues more shares, which Viacom did, it was going to issue, you know, $2 billion or $3 billion, whatever it was, more of shares, it was just going to be a natural dilution. I did not think it was going to go from like 100 all the way down to 45 bucks, you know, but I definitely would have sold. And I did sell, but I waited until 70. I held on, you know, until I was like, whoa, this is getting crazy. If it goes back up, it goes back up. I missed a train. But, you know, what happened is when that started selling off and Viacom started selling off at the same time, his Chinese position started selling off. You know, banks started calling like, yo, what's going on, dog? Like, where's our bread at, right? Because it was all on borrowed money. And when the asset's going down, they're not trying to lose the house either. And just like Robin Hood, they just forced him to sell. They put up, you know, 20 million, 30 million shares. And when you see big blocks up like that, it doesn't mean that the fundamentals of the company change, right? The company's still making money. It's still valuated. It's still growing. It just means that, you know, it was a fire sale. Like, this guy had to exit the position because he needed to liquidate because they needed cash. And that brings on this whole cycle that we're seeing right now is there really as much liquidity as we think there is in the market? Or is everybody just kind of swimming naked? And as Warren Buffett loves to say, it's not till the tide comes in, like this big event happens and the tide washes out and there's nothing left on the beach and you find out who's been swimming naked, right? Like who really has it, who really has the cash that has their positions? They're like, oh, well, this sucks. This stock's down 60%, but I know the company's great. It'll take a couple of years, it'll be back. And how many people were swimming out there like, oh shit, like I owe somebody, you know, 60% of something I don't have. So now I got to sell all this off and put cash in to make it whole. So that margin is very dangerous. Now look, margin could be a great tool to you know, I would never recommend it, but if you really were about it, you know, if you wanted to use margin to kind of establish a position, like, you know, I guess you would say, like, let's say you had 10 grand in your account and a stock really dipped and you're like, man, I really love this price. So you use, you know, an extra couple grand to buy the dip, you know, to buy the dip. And then, you know, in a couple of weeks and you get paid, you put money back in your account and you have the cash and you make it secure. Great. Right. But this is why margin is dangerous, because when stuff, it could grow your gains exponentially, right, at a faster pace. But also when it starts going down, it can also hurt you like crazy too. So, you know, a combination of both those things. And excuse me, to me, the craziest thing is there's not really no regulation on these swaps that these bigger companies are able to do. That blows my mind. It just blows my mind. You know, they're going to give us grief and give us, you know, shit pretty much for saying, oh, all these Redditors and these Robin Hooders, they don't know what the hell they're doing. They're just out here buying call options. They're just buying stocks. And it's like, what, just because, you know, we don't have billion-dollar accounts, you know, you're better than us? You know, where's the outrage at for these guys or for this guy? You know, because everybody else was involved? You know, and these guys were able to take on risk 5 times leverage. You know, they were just giving it out to them, and there's no real back end checking, like, hey, who's asking who for what. So it's like, you know, the way it worked, like if you were Wells Fargo and then our buddy over here was, you know, Goldman Sachs, and it showed in my account that I had $1 billion. Okay, well, I asked you, like, hey, I'll give you this much money if you go give me this much stock in Viacom. And so you buy a portion of that stock and you make your own bet thinking it's not going to go up, but you take my money up front and I'm giving you a portion of my money for buying a bigger stock option because it's done away from the regular market, right? This is where the big boys play so we don't disturb the market, right? And then I go make that same bet with Goldman, and then I go make that same bet with like Morgan Stanley and a bunch of these other guys, and they don't really know no one really knows what's going on, and everyone's just like, let it ride, baby. And all of a sudden a situation like this last weekend unfolds. And before you know it, boom, we got to start selling stuff because, you know, everyone just thinks stocks only go up, right? And you got this environment, and that's what makes me a little bit nervous about this environment is like, you know, everyone's a little bit too vested, and there's no doubt in my mind that everyone is over leveraged. And I don't think we've seen the last of these types of events this year. That doesn't mean the companies are bad. I still think Viacom is a great company, and I could do a whole nother video on why I'm invested in it and why I like it. I mean, you know, but, it just goes to show you when it's not the market that's irrational. It's people's behavior that's irrational, right? And that's all the stock market price is. It's a reflection of human behavior. And maybe it's oversold. Maybe it's not oversold enough yet. I don't know. That's for you to decide, right? But that's how we make money as investors, is we look for anomalies. Like, how did a stock go from 100 to 45 and nothing in the fundamentals changed? Maybe I should buy some of this stock, right? So I don't know. Love to hear you guys' thoughts on it. If you guys know more about it, drop a comment. I'm sure everyone's going to have some questions on it. But overall, I think we're going to be okay in the market overall. But like I said this 2 weeks ago, guys, I'm not all in right now, and this is exactly why. I mean, I just feel like there's a lot of things that are going to come up and a lot of challenges we're going to have, but it's like that in every year, every day in the market. That's why I love business. It's a new challenge. It's a new Rubik's Cube to solve, and it's not supposed to be easy. It's supposed to be difficult, just like, you know, but the way you navigate this is you got to use a little bit of intuition and a lot of educated guesses, right? And just smart risk management. Never go all in. If you like something, it goes on a fire sale, that doesn't mean go and fucking throw your whole, you know, bag at it. It's like, okay, buy up a little chunk of it, and a chunk you're okay with losing, you know, 3%, 5%, and let it play out for a week, a few days, see if it goes up or down, and then make your next move. So anyways, if you guys like the content, please share the video, help me grow the page, and screw IG for freaking banning me on live. I'm still kind of pissed about that. And it's making me nervous, making me almost saying, like, it's almost a way of silencing me, making me feel like, shit, I shouldn't even share anything political. But I don't know, man. We'll see what happens.